In our quest to analyze the wreckage of the ill-fated submersible, we have stumbled upon a treasure trove of evidence from the designer himself. This rare footage captures Stockton Rush discussing the intricate components of the submersible, providing invaluable insights into its construction. Join us as we dive deep into the details, unraveling what went wrong and what remains intact. This footage also serves as a testament to the designer's engineering prowess and unwavering belief in his creation. Together, let's meticulously analyze the footage, piecing together the puzzle.
So this is what's referred to as syntactic foam. Syntactic foam is foam that doesn't compress under pressure. So this will keep its size no matter how much pressure's on it. So it's, and it's expensive. This is about $15,000 worth of foam.
Syntactic foam is a specialized type of foam that is known for its unique property of not compressing under pressure. This means that regardless of how much force is applied to it, the foam retains its original size and shape. It's created by combining matrix material, typically a polymer resin, with hollow microspheres made of materials such as glass, ceramic, or polymer. These microspheres are uniformly dispersed throughout the matrix, creating a foam-like structure. The microspheres act as tiny rigid spheres that resist compression, providing the foam with its exceptional pressure-resistant properties. The matrix material in syntactic foam serves to bind the microspheres together and provides structural integrity to the material. Its unique characteristic makes it valuable in various industries and applications. For example, in the aerospace industry, it is used for lightweight structural components, buoyancy modules, and thermal insulation. Its ability to maintain its size and shape under extreme pressure is particularly beneficial in deep sea exploration, where it is used to make flotation devices for underwater vehicles and subsea equipment. Going back to our wreckage footage, we can clearly see its presence with no missing part, a testament on its reliability and its important role in keeping the components intact in one piece.
So on here, that's a mount for the laser scanner. We're actually using it for the CTD now. This will look a lot nicer when it has its clothes back on. This is a box, I believe this is for the cameras, and it has a pressure compensator. So this makes sure that the pressure in here is always about, right now it's set at about 5 psi above ambient. So if it's 6,000 psi outside, this will be 6,005, so that if it gets a crack, the oil comes out and the water doesn't necessarily come in.
The pressure compensator in the camera box is of significant importance as it ensures that the pressure inside the box remains stable and slightly higher than the ambient pressure. This feature has several crucial implications for the functioning and protection of the electronic components. By maintaining a slightly elevated internal pressure, the pressure compensator prevents the ingress of water or other external substances into the box. In the event of a crack or breach, the slightly higher internal pressure acts as a barrier, making it more difficult for water to enter. Instead, any potential leakage would result in the oil inside the box escaping, effectively preventing water intrusion. This design is particularly valuable in applications where it operates in environments with significant pressure differentials, such as underwater or in deep-sea conditions. It also helped to ensure that it remains protected against water ingress even under high external pressures. By looking at the wreckage, it's actually hard to identify, as the footage glimpse doesn't give as much of details, but it's hard to survive under a catastrophic implosion.
The control spheres we were talking about are here. These are glass. They're about 3/4 inch thick glass, and they're two halves. They're filled with oil, so that were they to crack, it won't have an implosion. Glass has a bad reputation. If you have a sphere this size that cracks at Titanic depth is something like 10 sticks of dynamite. It's a massive amount of energy. But when it has oil, it doesn't. It's good.
The control spheres being discussed are made of thick glass, approximately 3/4 inch thick, and are divided into two halves. These spheres are filled with oil. It's probably acting like some sort of oil reservoir. Glass has a notorious reputation for being fragile and prone to shattering. If a glass sphere of this size were to crack, it could lead to a dangerous phenomenon called implosion. The oil, being a non-compressible fluid, helps maintain a consistent pressure inside the sphere even if cracks develop. By having oil inside, the sphere's integrity is preserved, and the likelihood of an implosion is significantly reduced. The importance of using oil-filled spheres lies in the mitigation of potential hazards and the preservation of safety. Without the oil, the cracking of a glass sphere of this size could release an enormous amount of energy, comparable to the destructive force of 10 sticks of dynamite. After meticulous analysis of the wreckage, it becomes evident that this particular component is missing. The absence of this component could potentially be attributed to two main factors: whether a massive explosion or the extreme pressure exerted at deep sea depths. Yet, determining the exact cause is challenging, due to the complexities involved in investigating such condition.
So we got the aft dome here. This is another 3.25-inch thick titanium dome, bolted to another titanium piece, glued to the carbon fiber. Carbon fiber is coated with Rhino Liner, which is sort of what the military uses. It stops water penetration at high pressure into the carbon fiber.
The aft dome is a crucial component of the structure, consists of multiple layers of materials designed to withstand the high pressure environments. It comprises a 3.25-inch thick titanium dome, bolted to another titanium piece, which is in turn bonded to carbon fiber. Carbon fiber, known for its strength-to-weight ratio, provides structural integrity and reinforcement to the dome assembly. To further enhance its resistance to water penetration under high pressure, the carbon fiber is coated with a protective layer called Rhino Liner. Rhino Liner is a substance commonly used by the military and is specifically formulated to prevent water from penetrating the carbon fiber, even under extreme pressures. This layered construction of titanium, carbon fiber, and Rhino Liner ensures that the aft dome remains strong and watertight in deep sea environments. The combination of materials and coatings serves to safeguard the structural integrity of the dome, protecting the interior components from the potential damage caused by water penetration. Continuing from the previous statements, a closer examination of the wreckage reveals a significant absence of both the aft dome and the carbon fiber hull. This absence suggests that these components bore the brunt of the massive implosion that occurred. Despite meticulous analysis of the wreckage, the aft dome cannot be found, indicating that it either shattered or was completely separated from the wreckage. Additionally, doubts are cast upon the effectiveness of the Rhino Liner coating applied to the carbon fiber hull. Its failure to prevent water penetration is evident, as evidenced by the compromised state of the carbon fiber hull. This failure raises concerns about the Rhino Liner's capability to fulfill its intended purpose, further raising doubts about its reliability in high-pressure deep-sea environments. Moving on, the last piece and the most crucial for our investigation, the viewport.
It's acrylic, plexiglass.
Wow.
Yeah, and it is 7 inches thick. It weighs about 80 pounds. And when we go to the Titanic, it will squeeze in about 3/4 inch. It just deforms. And acrylic's great because it squeezes in, and before it cracks or fails, it starts to crackle. And so you get a huge warning if it's going to fail.
The acrylic plexiglass is a specific type of glass made from acrylic material, known for its transparency and durability. In this case, the acrylic plexiglass is approximately 7 inches thick and weighs about 80 pounds. The importance of the acrylic plexiglass lies in its ability to withstand pressure and provide a transparent barrier. When subjected to high pressures, such as when exploring the depths of the Titanic, the acrylic plexiglass undergoes a notable phenomenon known as the acrylic spring. As the pressure increases at great depths, the acrylic plexiglass compresses or squeezes in by about 3/4 inch. This compression results in the formation of the acrylic spring, which indicates the structural response of the material. Upon last examining to the wreckage, it is evident that the port found no traces of the plexiglass component mentioned. This absence raises concerns regarding the reliability and strength of the plexiglass material, making it a potential weak point in the overall structure. The inability of the plexiglass to withstand the forces at play during the implosion could be a contributing factor to its disintegration into pieces with no identifiable remnants found. The absence of any remains or indications of the plexiglass component further suggests that it failed catastrophically under the immense pressure and forces experienced during the implosion event. This failure raises questions about the structural integrity and suitability of plexiglass for such high-pressure deep-sea environments. It is crucial to critically evaluate the performance and capabilities of materials used in constructing components like plexiglass. In conclusion, despite the claims of precautionary measures made by Rush, the unfortunate implosion happens. The event has led us to consider two possible scenarios. The first scenario suggests that the implosion occurred due to the failure of the viewport under immense water pressure, causing water ingress and resulting in a catastrophic explosion of the submersible. The second scenario revolves around the use of three different materials, specifically the bonding of carbon fiber and titanium with glue. This combination raises concerns about structural integrity, potentially contributing to the implosion. However, the most notable aspect is the absence of the aft dome, which was neither mentioned nor seen in the recovered wreckage. This missing component adds further mystery and complexity to the incident. It is unclear whether it shattered into countless pieces during the implosion or if it was forcefully propelled away from the wreckage due to the aggressive nature of the implosion. Alternatively, there is a possibility that it is situated somewhere within the depths, eluding discovery thus far. We appreciate your engagement and value your thoughts and ideas. As we delve into the details of the incident, what do you believe truly happened to the aft dome in this case?